So tonight, I'm very excited to introduce Dr. Hal Schott, who will present My Old Horse Is Not Shedding Out This Spring and Its Feet Seem Sore. What is going on? So Dr. Schott received his DVM degree in 1984 from The Ohio State University College of Veterinary Medicine. He started his career with 3 years of private equine practice in Southern California. Dr. Schott subsequently pursued advanced training by completing a residency in equine internal medicine and a PhD in equine exercise physiology from Washington State University. Since 1995, Dr. Schott has been an equine medicine clinician at Michigan State University with a strong clinical interest in urinary tract disorders and endocrinological disorders of PPID and insulin dysregulation. Further, in 2017, Dr. Schott started the Equine Welfare in Practice Annual Clinical Clerkship for final year DVM students. This clerkship, he will take a group of students to perform veterinary care for working equids in rural Mexican communities in collaboration with faculty veterinarians and veterinary students from 2 universities in Mexico. Dr. Schott has won numerous state and national awards for his excellence in community engagement, teaching, and research. And with that, welcome, Dr. Schott.
Thank you very much, Dr. Strakota, and welcome to all of the people that are out there in cyberspace with us this evening. And some I see on the West Coast and one from Florida. So it's a beautiful day here in mid-Michigan, so spring is coming early. As Dr. Strakota mentioned, my actual training was in internal medicine and exercise physiology early in my career. But as many of us have grown older with the aging equine population, we've come to recognize that Cushing's disease, or what we now know as pituitary pars intermedia dysfunction, is becoming quite a common problem that we have to deal with. And it's a problem that unfortunately we can manage, but we can't cure because it's a degenerative process we'll talk a little bit more about. But the classic things that we see here is, again, that the horses just are not shedding out. Here's a pretty good example of a long hair coat, and this horse came to us in June with Dr. Caroline Berglass, one of the residents who studied this disease with me. And you can see actually Dr. Strakota here years ago with another horse with PPID. And this horse actually has some sun bleaching of the long hair that can occur over time when it's not shed out. And then really one of the main clinical problems we worry about, I think you can look at these feet of this horse named Bonnie right here and see that they have a dished appearance to long toe. And so she suffers also from chronic laminitis. And so the coupling of the sore feet and the long hair coat is pretty typical of PPID in horses. So before we really get into the discussion of the endocrinologic disorder, I just wanted to come up with some definitions a little bit. We use the condition or term geriatric for, you know, disorders or medical problems of the elderly. And one of the things we know about aging is that aging is not equal to all people. Some 80-year-olds look like they're 60, and some 60-year-olds look like they're 80. So geriatric, the term really means the loss of the physical condition, organ function, and the responses of our immune system as we age. However, it's not that closely linked necessarily with chronological age, or actually our age in years. But we have to sort of put some sort of terminology to get an idea of where we're at with horses. And so currently our accepted definitions for older horses start out with horses that we just call age. And those are horses over the 15 years of age. We reserve the term old until they turn to be about 20 years of age, and then very old for greater than 30 years of age. And in the Q&A, it was very clear that many of you have the horses that fall in this old or approaching the very old category. But there are some really, really old horses that have been described in the past. And this one was described back in the 1700s and 1800s. This was a horse named Old Billy over in the United Kingdom. And he pulled a barge along the canals and rivers there in the UK. He was reported to have reached the grand old age of 62 years, although I guess back then with those records, you have to call that or take that with a grain of salt. But this is his skull actually here that's on display in a museum in Manchester in the UK. And what you can see is how irregular his cheek teeth are at this age. And we know that that's one thing about horses is that their cheek teeth, their molars and their premolars, continue to slowly erupt throughout their entire lives, and they slowly wear them down by chewing and grinding on hay. And after a while, they finally run out of those teeth. And as they do that, then it's hard to keep body condition in appropriate stores for them. But the feed companies have helped us out a lot by coming up with senior feeds to help these horses that can't masticate or chew hay very well anymore. A little bit better documented is a couple of horses here, a horse and a pony. On the right is a horse named Shane, and he was reported to be 51 years old when he passed away. And on the left is a little pony named Sugarpuff. Both of these horses resided in the UK, and Sugarpuff was 56 years old. And actually, Sugarpuff was in pretty good health up until that point. He basically collapsed overnight and died very quickly. And we do recognize clinically that ponies tend to live longer than horses. For those of you then have the 32-year-old, you really might be thinking, how could that horse live out into its 40s? But again, most of them don't get to be nearly these age. And I think if you look at these pictures, you can see both of them tend to have a little bit shaggier hair coats and have a degree of PPID. This is some data that was collected from the USDA, and there's a program called the NOMS program, and that stands for National Animal Health Monitoring System. And they try to do these surveys about every 10 years just to get an idea of horse populations in the United States, as well as different types of problems that are experienced on different horse operations around the country. And if we just look at here, the USDA NOMS data from 2005 on the left and 2015 on the right. And if we look at the bottom here, we can see horses in the 20 to 30 year category, and then horses that are over 30 years of age. And these are the percentages of the total population, working out to about 7.5%. If we come 10 years later, not surprisingly, I think we all recognize that horses are living longer and getting older, and also they're not being replaced as well by young horses. So you can look here and see that in 2005, 7.5% of the horses were foals, less than 6 months of age. But here we only have about 3%. So there's less horses replacing the ones that are growing older. And the older horses have grown up to over 10% of our population. So it's pretty clear that horses are getting older, just like the human population. So we can also look at this NOMS data and answer or try to address the question, what is going to end up causing our horses either to die or to be put to sleep? And not surprisingly, we also can sort of get an idea of the turnover of these horses by their mortality rates. So for horses in the 15 to 20 years of age range, about 5 to 6% of these are lost annually. So that's the death rate for that age group of horses. Not surprisingly, when they get over 30 years of age, the death rate's quite a bit higher. So about a third of those horses die each year. What actually causes their death, or what leads people to make a decision for euthanasia? And one complaint is simply old age. And you can see here on this picture on the right, this horse has two enlarged knees, or what we call the carpi, our wrist equivalents, and they're pretty arthritic. And they have just difficulty getting up and down and get to be a little bit grumpy with their arthritis, despite some medications we can use to control the arthritic pain. And so just old age in general is a common reason for euthanasia. Belly aches or colic, and many of you may have heard of what's known as a strangulating lipoma, a little fatty tumor that can wrap around the small intestine and lead to the need for either surgery for colic or euthanasia. That's a cause. And we do see cancer in older horses as well. And then other diseases can cause weight loss, things like the kidneys start to fail or the liver starts to fail, or the heart even starts to fail in some older horses. A lameness or an injury. So again, the arthritis over here would be causing some lameness. And then we see some neurologic disease and respiratory disease. But interestingly, as the USDA has been collecting this data, what we don't see on this list is Cushing's disease, or what we now call PPID. So that's a comorbidity or a problem that develops in older horses, but not as really is a common cause of either death or euthanasia. So here's what my daughter asks me. This is my daughter, Melissa. And when she was about 6 years old, we got her our pony named Rusty. Now, as many of us acquire animals, we don't know their exact ages when we acquire them. From his teeth, we estimated Rusty to be about 15 years of age. And now my daughter's grown up and she's gone off to medical school, and Rusty still lives in our backyard. And you can see he's looked pretty good over this last 15 years, and how long he's going to live, don't really know. He can no longer eat hay. He makes quids, which are little balls of chewed up grass or hay that he tries to eat. And they range and they look like little pearls that he leaves everywhere for us. But as long as we give him some senior twice a day, he seems to be doing pretty well. He's happy and he's running in for a senior. So we hope Rusty continues to hang on for a little while. And I hope all of a sudden he just has a final episode and we find him not interested in a senior one morning or that he's died peacefully overnight. So he's going to live to be hopefully another 5 or 10 more years, but we just don't know. So we know in this aging equine population, we're recognizing Cushing's disease or PPID a lot more commonly. Is this disease really on the increase, or is it just that we're recognizing it more because horse owners like you are demanding better care of their older pets and they're kept as pets? And 20 to 40 years ago, we might have had a horse that was no longer being useful at 22 to 25 years of age and it would just be put to sleep. Now we consider these animals more as part of our family, as companions. So we're trying to give them a good quality of life for as long as possible. So there's no real evidence that Cushing's disease is increasing, but with the advancing age of the horse population, we are recognizing it quite a bit more. And again, we've already talked about how horses outgrow their teeth. This is an x-ray of an old horse with PPID. And when he was 4 or 5 or 6 years old, these tooth roots would have gone way up high in up to the sinuses and down low. And this teeth obviously can't masticate feed very well. But the feed companies have done a really good job at getting these complete feeds to allow these horses to sustain years of further life. And oftentimes we soak these pelleted feeds with a little bit of warm water and feed it once or twice a day, depending on the horse's needs. And it has really prolonged the life of many horses. So to answer the question, how common is equine Cushing's or equine PPID? We can look to a couple of studies. One of the first ones at looking at the prevalence or the occurrence of this disorder was in the Queensland, Australia area, and looking at by surveying a large group of sort of pony club members in that area. So the first study, they interviewed about 963 horse owners, and they simply asked the question, how many of your horses are slow to shed out their hair coat? So that's the most common clinical sign, so delayed shedding or failure to shed. And these were all horses that were at least 15 years of age, so the ones where we would expect to start seeing signs of PPID. And they found that about 20% of that population of nearly 1,000 older horses over 15 years of age had delayed hair shedding or failed to shed, so that would support PPID. About 5% of these horses also had laminitis. So that's another problem that can develop with PPID, as well as another disorder of insulin we'll talk about a little bit later. In the second phase of this study, they collected blood samples and they measured some hormones that tend to be elevated in horses with PPID. The one you may have heard about is ACTH. That's our common screening test to measure this hormone to see if it's elevated. Another similar hormone is called alpha MSH. We don't have a commercial lab that measures that, but in research studies, it's been shown to be elevated. So in this subgroup of about a third of these horses where they actually collected blood samples, they found 49 to have elevated ACTH. Again, these were greater than 15 years of age. So about 15% of the population also had supportive evidence of PPID or Cushing's disease by these elevated hormone concentrations. A similar study over in the United Kingdom that was in 2011 looked at even older horses. So they looked at horses that were over 30 years of age, and they didn't measure any blood samples to look for these hormone elevations, but they found that about 40% of the equids over 30 years of age had the hair coat changes consistent with Cushing's disease. And they also noted again that ponies were overrepresented in this grouping here. So take-home message is over 15 years of age, about 15 to 20% of horses are going to have it. Getting up to 30 years of age, about 40% of horses are going to have it. So that tells us that this is a slowly developing disease of aging and older horses. So let's go and talk a little bit about the pituitary gland itself. So here we have a representation of a horse's brain cut in cross-section. This is the cerebral cortex, the big thinking part of the brain, much smaller in a horse than it is in a person. This is the cerebellum at the back part of the brain, and that coordinates all of our movements. And then we have the brain stem going into the spinal cord through here. Well, the pituitary gland is a small gland that rests right below the brain. It's actually connected to the brain by a little stalk of tissue called the infundibular stalk. And actually, a lot of the activity in this pituitary gland is controlled by nerves or neurons that originate in this part of the brain called the hypothalamus. So we have what we call the hypothalamic pituitary axis for a lot of hormonal control of different organs in the body. So it depends where it goes. The hormones are produced in the pituitary gland under the control of these hypothalamic neurons. And then those hormones can go to the testicles or the ovaries or the adrenal gland or other parts of the body like the thyroid gland. So here's a sort of a schematic or a drawing of the pituitary gland. This would be our hypothalamus here. A lot of nerves coming from the hypothalamus down into the pituitary gland. This large part of the pituitary gland is what's called the anterior or pars distalis. And this is the largest part of the pituitary gland, and it has lots of different cells that produce different hormones. And we've just color-coded them here a little bit. So for example, we could say that these yellow colored cells would produce hormones that are going to affect the testes in a male horse or the ovaries in a mare. We could say that the blue ones are going to go to the thyroid gland and they produce a hormone called thyroid stimulating hormone. The ones going to the gonads or ovaries and testes would produce things like follicle stimulating hormone or luteinizing hormone to control development of follicles and to control ovulation. These pink stippled ones could be called corticotropes, and they produce ACTH, adrenocorticotropic hormone, that goes to the adrenal cortex in front of the kidneys to stimulate production of the hormone cortisol. And I think we're all familiar with the anti-inflammatory effects of cortisol and cortisone. So the hormones produced in the pituitary part of the gland here are under control again of these hypothalamic neurons, and they're secreted into a bloodstream collection system that goes to the rest of the body into the distant glands. In people and dogs, Cushing's disease arises spontaneously as a small tumor forms within this pars distalis. This tumor is from these corticotrope cells, and they proliferate spontaneously. And as they get larger and larger, they produce more and more ACTH, which goes on to affect the adrenal glands. And we get extra cortisol in the body and a syndrome of cortisol excess. And so in dogs and people, we see some different clinical signs than we see in the horses. The dogs certainly don't get the long hair coats, and people don't either get long, shaggy hair. They get loss of muscle, which is a similar sign as we see in horses with PPID. But again, there's some differences. And the reason for those differences is because Cushing's disease in horses develops from a different part of the pituitary gland. So if we look in horses, there's another thin layer of the pituitary gland called the pars intermedia, which separates this anterior lobe from the back lobe or the posterior lobe. And it's typically just a little thin strip of tissue, and it's composed of a single cell type called a melanotrope. Okay. Now, over time, these melanotropes start to undergo what we call hyperplasia, and they expand this pars intermedia, and it gets bigger and bigger due to proliferation of these cells. And then eventually we can get small tumors called microadenomas, or a larger tumor, a macroadenoma. That just means it's a centimeter in diameter or bigger, but it's all of these melanotropes. And then they start to produce more and more hormone because there's more and more cells, and they produce a variety of hormones we'll talk about on the next slide a little bit. But to distinguish Cushing's disease in horses from that in dogs and people, we've adopted the new term of PPID, or pituitary pars intermedia dysfunction. Again, here's a big pituitary adenoma, sort of the end stage of this disease. So again, we've taken away the term equine Cushing's disease and used pituitary pars intermedia dysfunction. And we like the term dysfunction because that means there's clinical disease or clinical signs associated with the expanded pars intermedia that's producing more hormones than it should. And PPID is not a consequence of a spontaneous small and then larger tumor forming in the pituitary gland. It's actually due to loss of these hypothalamic dopaminergic neurons. So if we go back here, the disease actually starts up here in the hypothalamus, and these dopaminergic neurons that innervate the pars intermedia start to die off or undergo degeneration. And as they do that, there's less and less dopamine secreted to the pars intermedia melanotropes. Now, that dopamine in the normal horse actually suppresses the activity of the pars intermedia melanotropes and decreases or keeps a basal level of hormone being produced by those cells. As we lose the dopaminergic neurons and the pars intermedia expands, we get lack of regulation. The loss of dopamine allows these cells to produce the hormones in an unregulated fashion. They produce more and more over time. So again, I tend to think of PPID more as a primary brain disease in horses rather than a primary pituitary gland disease. If we think about this equine PPID, it's a very, very slowly progressive disease. And it progresses over the period of several decades. And what we have over here on the right is a cartoon of the normal pituitary gland that would be at the base of the hypothalamus in the brain. And we see three different colors. What we can see is this sort of fuchsia is the pars anterior, the pars distalis, where those chromophobes make ACTH in small animals, and the thyrotropes make the TSH for the thyroid gland, and the gonadotropes make the hormones affecting the ovaries and the testes. There's a very thin blue stripe of this pars intermedia tissue in the normal pituitary, and then we have the pars nervosa, or the posterior, and that's where hormones for water balance are stored. But this pars anterior sort of wraps around it like your hand, one hand grabbing the fist, with the hand wrapping around being the pars anterior and the fist being the pars nervosa, and this tiny little sliver in between of the pars intermedia. On microscopic sections of the pituitary gland, we can actually see this, and this is stained with different stains to outline, again, the pars anterior, this thin strip of pars intermedia, and then the pars nervosa or posterior. Over a period of 10 to 15 to 20 years, as the dopaminergic neurons slowly degenerate, which is a sort of a normal process of aging. So it happens in most horses, but at different rates. So most horses will have changes over their lifespan, but they might not end up with clinical disease or pituitary pars intermedia dysfunction or clinical signs. So this is graded anywhere from a 1 up to a 5. And what we can see in this 5 is now we have a tumor, a macroadenoma, that's more than a centimeter in diameter. And that's all we see is this pars intermedia tissue. This grade 4 is a little bit smaller, and we can actually see this little round microadenoma, less than a centimeter in diameter. And they can have multiple ones of these. So in most horses, this process is developing. And we think it's just due to cumulative oxidative stress, damage to tissues. And that's what happens as we age, and we slowly get wrinkles, and our kidneys don't work as well, and our liver doesn't work as well. It's all part of the aging process. So we can get this hyperplasia developing to this grade 2 to 3 stage in horses as young as 5 years of age, but may not be evident until a horse is 25 years of age. And the progression and why one starts earlier and one starts later is not very well known. It may be that they get to this grade 4 as early as age 10, but more likely maybe by age 30. And this sort of end stage of the disease, probably the earliest we'll see that is horses that are about 15 years of age and may not develop again until horses are 40. So we could have a horse that's 30 years of age with this stage of disease yet show no clinical signs. Only when they get to be this latter part of the 4 and the 5 do we start to see the outward clinical signs of Cushing's disease. These melanotropes that are proliferating in this pars intermedia produce a hormone that's large. It's called a prohormone or pro-opio-melanocortin. One fragment of that POMC is ACTH that is released into the bloodstream, and that ACTH is what we measure as our screening test for PPID in horses. Now, the way, again, I think of this being more of a primary brain disease, secondarily affecting the pituitary adrenal axis, has some similarities to this disease in people, Parkinson's disease. And unfortunately, some of you may have family members or relatives that have suffered from Parkinson's disease. And what we know about Parkinson's disease is that there's a variety of clinical signs associated with it. And unfortunately, in some people, it tends to start fairly early. So you can see here, Michael J. Fox over on the right-hand side, we know that he started to suffer from Parkinson's disease when he was quite young, and he has made a really significant advance by developing foundations and funding sources for research in Parkinson's disease, but he struggled a long time with this disorder. On their left is our famous boxer, Muhammad Ali. He also developed Parkinson's disease later in age, but he also probably had multiple injuries. He probably had a combination of traumatic brain injury as well as Parkinson's disease. But again, they have different, not always the same exact clinical signs or age at onset. But I think if you recognize people with Parkinson's disease, they may start with a minor twitching or shaking of the hands at age 55 or 60, and it may not progress to a debilitating disease until they're 75 or 80 years of age. So again, Parkinson's disease is caused by a similar degeneration of hypothalamic neurons in the brain. And as they slowly degenerate, we see these clinical signs develop. Now, why don't horses with PPID shake and show the signs of Parkinson's disease? Well, it's because another area of the hypothalamus is affected in Parkinson's disease called the substantia nigra compared to the part of the hypothalamus that's affected in horses. But one of the commonalities that we also can see are things called silent seizures. And people with Parkinson's disease, sometimes they're just turned off for 30 seconds. It's like they're not there. The lights are on, but nobody's home. And we sort of recognize that sort of clinical neurologic deficit in some older horses with PPID. They just seem to be not quite there, but you know they're doing okay, but they're just not quite alert like we used to remember them. And one of the earliest improvements we see when we put them on medication to replace that dopamine, a drug called pergolide, is that they wake up and they actually act like they're a few years younger. So we do again see these overlaps, and that's why I like to compare PPID to Parkinson's disease. So the clinical syndromes that we see, obviously the long shaggy hair coat, we see a loss of top line muscle, and that can be associated with extra cortisone that's going on. A funny thing in horses is they can get these supraorbital fat deposits, and that's sort of characteristic of PPID. Sometimes they'll get cresty necks as well, but that can go along with a problem with insulin. And here on the bottom are the things that we probably deal with more or more serious problems. We can always body clip a horse like this. We can try some nutrition to try to improve the muscle mass here. But when they start to get problems with their feet, the laminitis, that can be devastating because it can be painful. And if it's not controllable, that can be the reason that these horses are put to sleep. We also can see that the cortisol can affect some of the suspensory ligaments and tendons of the limbs. And this is a horse with dropped fetlocks from a suspensory ligament damage. And this can be very painful and was actually the reason for euthanasia in this horse. So here's a 28-year-old quarter horse cross. His name was Teton. He had a several-year history of a long hair coat that failed to shed, and he had chronic founder issues. But his job in life was to take care of this little girl, and she loved him dearly, and she could still ride him around a little bit. Now, looking at this horse, you know, the question is, does this horse have PPID? And this is an over-the-fence diagnosis. You can look at the horse, and like Bonnie, the one with long hair coat I showed in the beginning, this horse obviously has PPID. Okay. Now, is medical treatment of this condition warranted? And that's a decision that we have to talk about with each horse owner and each horse because there's obvious implications. When we start to think about is medical treatment warranted, I start to ask a couple of questions or ask that. Okay. Or as clients, you would ask me these questions. So, will medical treatment improve my horse's quality of life? And I think we can pretty confidently answer this question, yes, probably in two-thirds, if not three-quarters of horses that are started on the medication pergolide, their quality of life does improve. Okay. Is it going to make my horse live longer? And the answer to that, unfortunately, is not necessarily, because again, common reasons for euthanasia are not necessarily the Cushing's disease itself, but a strangulating lipoma causing colic, some arthritis that gets to be debilitating. So it's not necessarily going to prolong the horse's life, but it should improve the years that the horse has left. Is it going to decrease the risk of future laminitis? And this is a question which we don't have a great answer to, but it possibly could decrease the risk of laminitis because it could increase the health of the hoof tissue itself. Unfortunately, once laminitis develops, it can be a recurrent problem. We never completely cure laminitis to get back a normal hoof, but we can control the pain and control that so the horse can oftentimes become successful again. So what medication should be used? There's really only one medication out there that's really good for this, and that is pergolide. Okay. And Pergolide was licensed through the FDA by Boehringer Ingelheim back in 2009. And actually at MSU, we were one of the largest study sites looking at this, and it was a home run. This drug did really, really well. And it helps the vast majority of horses. And I know probably at the end, one or two of you might have a question about, my horse doesn't take Pergolide. And for a small subset of horses, it seems to taste terrible and they really hate taking it. And there is a potential solution for that with another injectable drug, which we can talk about a little bit at the end. But again, that's the drug. Now, again, should all horses be treated? And I'm going to talk to you about two Morgan horses that we managed here at Michigan State for a long time. The horse on the left was a good show horse in his teens in the earlier years, but he started to have slow shedding back in 1998, so a long time ago. And he was presented to us at the college because he had sore feet. He had recurrent laminitis. And so we did some diagnostic testing back then, and it was supportive of Cushing's disease. And he was started on Pergolide back in 1998. And here he is in August of 2005. He's been retired from work now and actually lived at a retirement farm and was doing pretty well. He's now 26 years old. Now, in contrast, here's another Morgan that actually was the same age. He was 26 years old in June of 2005, and he started also have slow shedding of his hair coat back in 1998. Fortunately, Honor, who also was a good show horse and was actually quite overweight during his showing years, he never developed laminitis, and he was owned by one of our front office staff here at the college. And unfortunately, she was helping put her grandchildren through school and through college, so she did not have the extra financial resources to go ahead and put Honor on Pergolide. So we just did other things to try to have good quality of life for him, and he was not treated. Here's Honor a couple years later. He's now 29 years old. 10 years after the initial diagnosis, you can see his patchy hair coat. He's in pretty good body condition. And he actually developed a colic at that period of time. And they said, okay, it's time to let him go. He'd been retired, so he's put to sleep for colic. But he had a pretty good 10 years without specific medical treatment. He was intermittently body clipped. They paid careful attention to his feet with trimming and nutrition and dental work, and he did pretty well. Magic stayed on Pergolide through this whole time, and he started to have problems with his teeth as well, and so he came to see us again in August of 2009, 11 years after initial diagnosis, and this is almost a year after Honor was put to sleep, and he had very little cheek muscles left, so he couldn't chew hay, and you know, he was at the retirement farm, and what he needed was to get more senior feed, and they increased the senior feed on him, and he came back just about 4 months later. He put on quite a bit of weight and was doing pretty well, but this was now a horse had been a retirement farm for almost going on about 8 or 9 years, and the owner just said, you know, I no longer really come and visit. The owner was getting old as well, and they elected to put him to sleep at that time. Now, if we look at what the resources the owner actually put into Honor or to Magic all of those years, using an average value of about $1.50 per milligram of Pergolide, he ended up spending nearly $10,000 on Pergolide. And this was before we had the percent, so these are different compounded products. And his overall medical expenses were over $15,000. So clearly not everybody can have that luxury with their older horses. And that's why there's important question is, do we want to treat the horse with the medication in the first place? And that's a decision that you have to make. Okay. A couple other things that we've seen over the years. This is a 22-year-old saddlebred gelding, and this horse actually did not have a problem with his hair coat. He looked pretty slick. Got a little bit of a crusty neck you can see here, loss of his top line muscle, and his ribs are starting to show. And he was drinking and urinating a lot more than normal, and he didn't have any laminitis, but on laboratory findings, he had a persistent increase in his blood sugar, his blood glucose, and he also had glucose in his urine. So he was actually a diabetic horse. And we've seen a handful of these diabetic horses without the obvious Cushing signs. And we have found that, yes, they test positive for PPID. And when we do put them on the Pergolide, we actually can control their diabetes without having to give them insulin like we would in people. So a different sort of presentation of PPID. And here's this mare I showed you with the drop fetlock. She was only 16 years old, an Oldenburg mare, and she was quite lame in her hind end, very painful, no laminitis. And when she came into us in April, she had been recently body clipped, so she was not shedding very well. And an ultrasound examination of her hind limb suspensory ligaments, there was severe disruption of this, and her blood ACTH concentration was elevated, supporting PPID. and she had quite enlarged pituitary gland at autopsy when we did put her to sleep because her pain was so severe, we thought it was only fair to put her to sleep. So again, sometimes we'll see this kind of complication as the primary problem with PPID. So yes, this horse could also have PPID. How about these horses here? This is a saddlebred mare who was about 18 years of age, and she was having a considerable problem getting her uterus cleared up from an infection. She had chronic endometritis, and they couldn't get her in full. And so some testing, even though her hair coat looked good, showed she did also have PPID. So some of the older mares that were having trouble getting in full, we might want to think about screening them for PPID. And if we can get the PPID under control and clear up this infection a little bit better, we might be able to get one or more two foals out of them. And this is just another horse that has a recurrent sinus infection from a tooth root infection, leading to this now foul-smelling nasal discharge. Well, again, his infection is not going to be cleared up very well when he has concurrent PPID. So with chronic infections, we have to look at, say, maybe there's underlying PPID making them less responsive than we would expect. I already mentioned these horses can also have this dull attitude and these seizure-like disorders. And we'll get calls about horses that actually have PPID and will have a collapsing episode that looks like a seizure. It doesn't appear to be exactly a seizure, but it's a seizure-like disorder. And the more we look, this dull attitude and these sometimes neurologic deficits might occur in up to about a third of the horses with PPID. And as I mentioned, it's one of the earliest clinical responses, if they have this dull attitude, that they sort of wake up a little bit and have a lot more activity once they go on the pergolide. So in these horses, without the classic long hair coat, PPID can be a challenging diagnosis, but it's something we should start thinking about as a comorbidity for these other problems like infections or other disorders in horses over about 15 years of age. So how do we approach these horses? Okay, so we look at the clinical signs and we can get supportive endocrine tests by measuring their ACTH. And then we have to ask the question, do we want to put them on pergolide or not? So each course and client has to make this decision. So if we just want to do management alone, it can help them out quite a bit. Good body clipping, dentistry for their teeth, and good nutrition for an older horse, the senior feeds. Maybe a little more attention to deworming. There's some evidence that they might get higher parasite burdens with their PPID. And we do treat the infections with antibiotics and sometimes surgery. And we need to do some farrier work and analgesics if they have laminitis. And a popular thing that we've been using over the last decade or so for horses with chronic laminitis are these wooden shoes called clogs for horses. They're made out of plywood and they're screwed in the foot and they're changed every 5 or 6 weeks. And they really help horses with chronic laminitis because they provide a lot of good support to the sole. And this bevel also allows the horses to roll off this clog in any direction. So it eases their breakover and improves their lameness. And then if we want medication, then we certainly can add that to the treatment program. And pergolide is, again, the best treatment, although, again, it can be costly over a period of time. So it's an important decision to think about. Is this something we want to go down that path? If we have the horse with PPID, we want to sort of have a good reassessment of the clinical signs of PPID once or twice a year. And this is a good thing to do in concert with spring shots and deworming. And if you have the veterinarian out in the fall for a fall exam, again, talk about PPID. And I want to encourage you to start thinking about measuring body condition scores on your horse, and we'll show a picture of that in a minute. You're probably already familiar with that 1 to 9 scaling, and to measure your horse's weight with a girth tape. They don't exactly correlate to what we weigh on the scale, but if a horse is gaining weight or losing weight, we can pick this up with the girth tape and the body condition scoring. This becomes really important prior to development of laminitis in overweight horses because we want to try to identify when they're becoming overweight and start to implement a diet before they founder or get laminitis. We're going to discuss nutrition and dentistry. Do we need a little bit more senior feed? Are we doing okay? Do we need a dental procedure? Is there a loose tooth or an infected tooth? And we don't have to always do endocrine testing, but if the horse isn't doing as well as we would like, we might consider an ACTH to see if it's still markedly elevated, even in a horse that's on pergolide. We'll talk a little bit more about insulin in a couple minutes. If we're on the pergolide, do we need to increase the dosage over time? In some horses we do, in some horses we don't. And again, we'll talk about if there's any infections that need treatment. And again, the same consideration of the good farrier work to control the hooves. And sometimes we have to add an analgesic, a non-steroidal drug, if there is pain from chronic laminitis. So again, body condition scoring, I encourage you to do this yourself. And what would be good to do is do this a couple of days before your veterinarian's coming out for the spring health exam and shots, and you make a list. And what we're really looking for with body condition scoring is assessing fatness. Okay, so we're looking for increased fat deposits, a crusty neck, behind the shoulders, covering the ribs, over the tail head. And unfortunately, we all like plump horses, and plump horses have been rewarded in the show ring over the last 10 to 20 years. So an ideal body condition score has a body condition score about 5, where you can just appreciate the ribs and certainly feel them as you take your hand along there. But most horses have their ribs covered up and are closer to body condition scores of 6 to 7 and 8, and that's overweight, okay? And we want to try to keep them more in this leaner, meaner type of configuration. Clients tend to underestimate their body condition score. So you might say, oh, my horse is a 5. I really like how he does it. And your veterinarian say, well, really, you're closer to a 7 because of this crusty neck and these other things. So we need to talk about what the horse is feeding, how much exercise it's getting. Okay. So take home messages I have for you for PPID are basically that we want to consider this as a contributing factor for many potential medical problems in horses over 15 years of age. Clearly, the earlier we recognize and manage PPID, the more likely it's going to improve the quality of life of these older equids, especially if we add pergolide to their treatment. Just like Michael J. Fox, though, if we have horses that are starting out with clinical signs of PPID in the range of 12, 13, 15 years of age, they're not really as likely going to live to be that 30-year-old horse. So the earlier onset suggests more advanced disease and give them a poor long-term prognosis. Okay, so let's talk more specifically about laminitis for the last few minutes. As I mentioned, at MSU, we were one of the study sites for the FDA trial for pergolide, or now the drug licenses percent. We had 41 horses enter that trial, and we asked the owners at the entrance of the trial, does your horse have any history of founder or laminitis? And 5 of the 41 horse owners said, yep, my horse certainly has. But we also looked a little more closely at the hoof conformation, and we took x-rays of the feet. And here's a horse with chronic laminitis where the coffin bone, or P3, is rotated away from the hoof wall. And this is the classic sign of laminitis. Okay. When we took x-rays, we found that 40% or more than 40% had radiographic evidence of laminitis. And so laminitis is under-recognized by many horse owners with horses with PPID. And about 50% of equids with PPID in the different studies that have looked at this do have some evidence of laminitis, either due to obvious lameness, or another thing is they might just have recurrent foot abscesses as the integrity of this hoof wall attachment to the underlying bone has degenerated over time with chronic founder. So recurrent foot abscesses are almost always a sign a horse has some degree of underlying laminitis. What's interesting is we can have horses with pretty nasty looking feet and pretty nasty changes, and they may not be very lame at all. So you can't predict lameness by just looking at the x-ray. And part of that might be some of the hormones that are increased with PPID can tend to have some anti-inflammatory effects and actually make the horses more comfortable. I mentioned the peptide POMC at the beginning, pro-opio-melanocortin. So they actually have higher levels of an opioid called beta endorphin in their spinal fluid that might make them more tolerant of these painful conditions. So why do they get laminitis? Well, it's not directly necessarily related to PPID. And you've heard of the term probably equine metabolic syndrome, which is this syndrome where we recognize laminitis in horses that are either turned out to spring or fall pasture where there's a higher sugar content of the pasture grass, or in horses that tend to be overweight. So obesity-associated laminitis and pasture-associated laminitis. And now we recognize that this is associated with an increase, either intermittently after eating or persistently all day long, elevated blood insulin concentration. So insulin is the hormone that is damaging the lamina in the hoof and leading to the laminitis. And so to diagnose EMS, we measure the insulin concentration to see if it's elevated. And if it's not elevated after a fast or just after several hours after a meal, we can stimulate an insulin response by giving a horse a dose of oral K-Ro syrup and measuring the blood insulin 90 minutes later or so to see if it's more elevated than it should be. The newer term we're talking about this syndrome is more insulin dysregulation. And this term goes along with the condition, again, equine metabolic syndrome in the past. But what we now know about insulin dysregulation is this naturally develops with aging. So a horse that's 20 years old is going to have a greater insulin response to a sugar meal than a five-year-old horse. And that happens in people as well. We also recognize that insulin dysregulation has an increased risk with obesity, and that there are certain breeds that are much more likely to develop insulin dysregulation than others. So ponies are more likely to it, as well as horses with the upright neck carriage. So our Morgans, our Saddlebreds, our Warmbloods, our Andalusians, where in contrast, our Thoroughbreds and our Standardbreds are less likely to develop this problem. And quarter horses actually are notably one of the breeds most resistant to developing the insulin dysregulation and laminitis. And people with this syndrome of insulin dysregulation, we see them progress into type 2 diabetes, so where their blood sugar is elevated and they need to take medications to control that as well as insulin. In horses, we rarely see the progression to type 2 diabetes, though I did show you that one horse with PPID that did have type 2 diabetes. What we tend to see, the clinical problem is laminitis. And why they are less likely to develop into type 2 diabetes, we don't fully understand that. Okay. About 50% of equids with PPID that have laminitis have evidence of concurrent insulin dysregulation. Now, the overlap between PPID and insulin dysregulation that could compound laminitis is if we have extra cortisol going around in the body. The healing of the lamina in the feet, which do try to heal slowly over time, again, not back to normal strength, but do try to heal, that cortisol will slow that healing process down. So we have a combination of insulin dysregulation and extra cortisol. It can sort of be a double attack on that laminar bed, making PPID a predisposing factor for more severe laminitis. Now, there are other horses, though, that don't have insulin dysregulation with PPID, and there are those that never founder, and they are just, in my opinion, lucky horses. Okay. So why does insulin cause laminitis? And that's a question we still don't really understand. This was actually a serendipitous discovery back in 2007 when they experimentally infused insulin for 2 to 3 days in horses and ponies. And they wanted to look at the effect of insulin on the tissues over that prolonged period of time. When we give a dose of insulin, it's going to drop blood sugar because insulin's role is to drive the sugar or glucose into the skeletal muscle and into the liver. So at the same time they gave them this extra insulin, and they gave them very large amounts of insulin to make it high in the blood, much more than it would be naturally, they had to give glucose simultaneously in the other intravenous catheter in a jugular vein. And what they wanted to see is, over time, did they have to give less glucose if the tissues would become refractory to the effects of insulin? So what happened, though, is they didn't expect it. In about 55 hours into the study, the ponies started showing signs of laminitis. And then they repeated this study in standardbred, young, healthy standardbred horses a couple years later, and they found that it actually induced laminitis even earlier at 44 to 48 hours. And the idea was, well, there's just more weight on these horses compared to ponies. So we don't fully understand why insulin causes laminitis, but we know that there is that association. So how can we decrease the risk of insulin-associated laminitis in our horses? Again, we can monitor this body condition score regularly to limit development of obesity before laminitis develops. We can consider testing for PPID in horses over about 15 years of age, as well as insulin dysregulation. But insulin dysregulation can occur in all ages of horses if they get overweight. So we can see five-year-old ponies or horses that are overweight that have insulin dysregulation laminitis. We're going to limit pasture access for at-risk equids. So if we have a Morgan that's 15 years old, that's overweight with a body condition score of 7, probably not the best idea to turn them out on May pasture this year, because that's going to increase the odds of laminitis. And we can feed these at-risk horses that are usually easy keepers a lower quality grass hay and a ration balancer. It always surprises me how, you know, people like to feed nice, good alfalfa hay to horses. Well, that hay is way too rich for most horses. It's for dairy cattle to make milk. And they want to also give them a little bit of concentrate feeds. But most of these horses, again, are easier keepers and don't need a concentrate feed. So lots of people think, well, I do need to feed some grain to my horses. Let's just put this in perspective. A typical 500 kilogram or 1,100 pound horse its daily caloric requirement's about 15 megacals per day, compared to our 2,500 kcals per day. It'd be fun to be able to try to eat 15 megacals a day. So this can be provided from 15 pounds of reasonably quality hay, grass hay, and a ration balancer. But let's say that you want to give your horse a little treat and you give it a pound of grain twice a day. So if we give them a pound of a concentrate feed, that's going to be up to 18 megacals per day. So 3 more megacals per day, or 1,000 extra megacals per year. And that simple 1 pound of grain twice a day can lead to a 75 to 100 pound weight gain. So if my horse has a body condition score already of a 6 to 7, what does it really need? Well, the feed companies have developed these low starch, low sugar feeds for these horses. But if they're already overweight, they don't really need this at all. They just need a muzzle when they go out to pasture to try to restrict their intake of the grass, and maybe a ration balancer with a lower quality hay diet. So when we think about the risk of insulin dysregulation and development of laminitis, we have to think about two factors. One are the genetic risk factors, and I've already sort of alluded to breed predispositions, ponies, upright neck carriages. And there probably are more genetics involved in this than we currently recognize. The group at University of Minnesota is looking at this quite a bit. But then we have environmental risk factors. More feed than the horse needs, excessive caloric intake, limited exercise, and maybe other environmental factors that we're yet to discover. Okay, so we have two circles. We can have a very small genetic risk, a very healthy quarter horse, and a horse that's on a good diet and a regular exercise. So its risk of ever developing laminitis from insulin dysregulation is very low. Or we can have the other extreme of high amount of genetic risk factors, extra food, limited exercise, and maybe some other, again, as yet unidentified risk factors. And then this horse has a very high risk of this. Okay. Unfortunately, we can't control the genetic side very well, but we can control the environmental side. That's what we need to focus on. Okay. So our approach to management of treating this insulin dysregulation, again, it's tailored for each horse and client. Management alone can work. So we're going to put them on less hay that they need, 12 to 14 pounds of hay a day. And we have to actually weigh this in a scale and put it in a bag and know what we're feeding every day. We're going to, if they're already laminitic, we're going to have to, again, use some good farriers and analgesics to control the laminitis pain. And we assess the progress every 30 to 45 days to see if the horses will lose some weight and their laminitis improves. Just like people, there's some horses that are very easy keepers and won't actually lose weight when we put them on this diet. If they don't, we have to actually restrict them a little bit more or even do some things. You know, we use these slow feeders or even feed them a little bit of straw. As with people, any diet, the long-term maintenance is the challenge, but this can work. So here's a horse we saw back in 2011 with laminitis and quite overweight, a body condition score of about 8. And over a period of just about 4 months from March to July, this horse lost 251 pounds, or about 2 pounds a day during that period of time, came back routinely for clogs on its feet. And by this time, you can see its ribs, and this horse was much, much happier. It was quite sound now. It was off all non-steroidal drugs and just needed regular hoof work. But the long-term maintenance is the challenge, keeping this horse from gaining the weight back, just like in people. Okay, so we also want to always give our horses some supplements. So these overweight horses are often put on different supplements, and there's some that are for horses that also have concurrent laminitis. You may have heard of giving these horses that are overweight thyroid hormone supplement, and that's not because their thyroid gland is not functioning adequately. It is. But if we make them have extra thyroid hormone, we know with hyperthyroidism or excessive thyroid, common in cats and people, we tend to see thin bodies. So that extra thyroid hormone drives metabolism. So we're actually using the thyroid hormone to supercharge metabolism and try to accentuate weight loss, not as a drug to replace a lack of thyroid hormones. And so if we have an overweight horse that's laminitic and can't exercise very much, we may recommend the thyroid hormones for the first 3 to 6 months of trying to get the horse under control. Other supplements, there's a lot of anecdotal evidence on the market. There are, you know, testimonials that these things like Hero work, and you can use them on a trial and error basis, but there's just not a lot of good scientific evidence. This is one that's also popular from Kentucky Equine Research in Lexington called Insulin Wise. And one of our faculty members here at MSU, Jane Manfredi, actually did some work with them. And what they found is they did this oral sugar test before and after they put them on the supplement for about 6 weeks. And here is insulin concentration on this y-axis. And this is minutes after dosing with oral sugar. And a horse should have a fairly flat line, only increased just a little bit, where a horse with insulin dysregulation goes up very high. And so on this supplement, this individual horse responded quite favorably. But in another horse in the same group of experimental horses, there was absolutely no effect of the insulin-wise on improving insulin dysregulation. So again, it can be used on a trial and error basis, but it's not going to help all horses equally. So recently, there's some medications to also use in addition to the diet program. The medication that's been around for 15 years or so is a human anti-diabetic drug called metformin. This supercharges the effect of the insulin in the body and makes it work better on the tissue. So it's called an insulin sensitizing drug. And we used to think that this drug was helpful, but it's sort of fallen out of fashion. It's not working as well as we thought. And that's because when we give the drug orally, we can't measure much of it in the bloodstream. So it doesn't seem to get absorbed across the stomach and intestine in the bloodstream. But more recently, it's been thought that maybe the effect of this drug doesn't have to be by being absorbed in the blood. It might work actually right in the intestine itself to limit intestinal absorption of sugar. So there was some excitement about whether you could give metformin maybe 60 to 90 minutes before you turn your horse out to pasture for the day. And a recent study published just a few months ago looked at that specific question and unfortunately showed that there was no improvement in the insulin response when horses were turned out to pasture when they were on this drug before turnout versus not on the drug. So it did not hold that promise. Most recently, and a bit more exciting, are some of the drugs that are also used for human diabetes. These are drugs called SGLT2 inhibitors. What's SGLT2? SGLT2 is a sodium glucose linked transporter. And this one actually worked. This transporter is in the kidney. And in the kidney, our blood is filtered through the glomerulus and glucose leaks out of that into the tubule. And 100% of that glucose is reabsorbed back into the bloodstream when we're healthy. And that's what we want it to do because we don't want to waste glucose out in our final urine. This filtrate has all the things that are in the blood, and then it's progressively modified as that filtrate goes along here until we get our final urine, which is excreting the waste products. Well, if we give a drug to block this, an inhibitor, it leads to glucose leaking through the entire kidney tubule and going out in the urine. And so if we waste glucose in the urine, we're going to lose energy that way and help with weight loss. There's a long list of these inhibitors, but there's excitement because one of the ones that's been studied the most is the sertugliflozin. And it's actually been shown to, in addition to help with weight loss, we see fairly dramatic and rapid improvement in some of the laminitis cases with insulin dysregulation. And I'll leave this slide up here for you. And there's a YouTube video that talks about this. And when this was first shown at our annual meeting of our equine practitioners in the fall of 2023, it was pretty dramatic how some of these horses improved their laminitis pain within just a couple of weeks before they really had substantial weight loss. So this is the newest drug on the horizon. There's a lot of interest in this drug. There is not a licensed product available through the FDA for horses yet. So we're off-label using this in some horses using the human drugs. So take-home messages with insulin dysregulation. It can develop and lead to laminitis at any ages when horses become overweight. So our goal is to limit them from becoming overweight, monitoring their body condition score before laminitis would ever develop. We know that certain breeds and advancing age are risk factors for development of EMS, insulin dysregulation. So we even have to be more conscientious in our Morgan horses or our Andalusian horses or our ponies to try to minimize that from happening. And limited development of obesity by monitoring, again, body condition scoring. Most horses that are fed grain don't need it, and many horses are no longer in exercise. So the last thing to think about if you have questions is walking we know is good for us, it's good for our dogs, and it's also good for your horse. So if you can't ride your horse anymore or find someone, certainly continuing some exercise is what we'd like to do. And I'd be happy with that to answer any questions. Sorry, I went a little longer than I expected.
Thank you, Dr. Schott, for a wonderful presentation. Now it's your opportunity to ask some questions. For those on Facebook Live, please type your questions into the comment section. We're going to take about 5 minutes of questions, and then we're going to do our prize winners for today. If we have additional questions, we will post comments on Facebook later on in the week. So let's see what questions we have in the Q&A. Dr. Schott, why, and you alluded to this already, but why are some horses resisting taking the pergolide medication? And specifically, this horse did fine for a couple of years and now is very much resisting pergolide.
Yeah, that's a little unusual. Usually, when we see the problem, it is usually right when we start the pergolide. And we don't know why, but we know that there is a small percentage of horses that just seem to hate the taste of this drug. And you can flavor it, you can put it in an apple core, you can do anything. And some horses, you know, will get calls, the horses are starting to run away from people because they don't like it. Fortunately, this happens again in less than 5% of horses. There is another medication called cabergolide. It's a similar dopamine-like drug to replace the dopamine that can be given by injection. And that injection is given weekly. There is a compounded form that can be acquired from a lab in Kentucky, and they're working on trying to get this product licensed for use as well. And because it's a weekly medication, it's a lot more convenient, but it sometimes can cause a little decrease in feed intake associated with it. So that's a concern that you would find out by trial and error. But we only really recommend this medication, and the horses absolutely refuse and hate the pergolide. Why they refuse, I don't know. And why your horse started to do it after a couple of years, that would be uncommon in my experience. Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Schott. Question here. Do you encounter PPID cases that are resistant to treatment with Percent? And if so, how do you manage them? You kind of already said cabergoline, but.
Yeah, cabergoline and all the other management factors we talked about. Okay. Unfortunately, not all animals respond to the drug similarly. But again, this was one of the better responses we've seen with a drug in an FDA trial. Oftentimes, they're only looking for about 40% of horses to actually show favorable responses. And in the trial, about 70% did. That means 30% didn't. And the things that are going to be poor prognostic indicators are going to be if the disease becomes more obvious early. So if it's a 15-year-old horse with advanced signs of Cushing's disease, probably not going to live to be 20, and it's probably not going to respond to pergolide as well. We can try to slowly increase the dose, and sometimes that helps, but unfortunately, if they don't respond favorably in that first, you know, 30 to 90 days of treatment, then that's going to be a poorer outcome. So next one I see is, can you reverse insulin dysregulation completely without medication? You can improve it considerably. And if you get the animal in a lean body condition and you get a good diet going and keep an exercise, you can certainly get the response normal. Now, unfortunately, we can't reverse the age-related tendency for insulin dysregulation that is going to also develop. So we can certainly improve it. And we try diet and exercise always as the first round before we put them on medication. The medication is going to be more for those that are having difficulty losing weight and or refractory laminitis, and then we would try that. And this is a great question from Angela. Are ration balancers contributing to weight gain in PPID horses? Are they insignificant caloric intake? They're insignificant calories. If you think of 15 pounds of hay versus a handful of a ration balancer, the benefits of the ration balancer with the vitamins and minerals in there, they're not really of concern that way. Okay. What is the name of the injectable? Cabergoline, C-A-B-E-R-G-O-L-I-N-E. And the lab that makes it in Kentucky is called BET, B-E-T Labs. Great, Cher. Good to hear the good news. Well, if you're testing your hay, Tina, you say your grass hay is higher in sugar than our alfalfa hay, well, I would feed the lower sugar hay for sure. That's very, very unusual to have grass hay be higher than your alfalfa. Now, in that situation, one of the things you can do to decrease the sugar content in both hays is you can soak it for a good half hour, 60 minutes in water, and that will leach out some of that sugar. Sure, let's see. Where we're at here. I'll let you take the next one, Doctor. Where are we?
Yeah, I think overall, we have the same questions about hay and what's best to regarding sugar intake and the type of hay. Is it okay to soak your hay for 30 full minutes to reduce sugar?
I think 30 minutes gets a fair bit out. You'll see different recommendations, 60 minutes or even overnight. Here in Michigan, where it's usually cold this time of year, soaking can be a little challenging, but you'll get a fair bit out within 30 to 60 minutes. So here's a question from Kim. If you have an older horse like mine, 25-year-old quarter horse mare, would it be worth testing for PPID or insulin resistance if they're only showing a few signs or irregular signs, not like growing up a coat or personality changes? You know, again, it's a case-by-case basis. If we had to look at the pituitary gland, your horse is going to have an enlarged pars intermedia, no question. Most horses by age 15 are going to have large pars intermedia. But the signs you're seeing are pretty mild. If you get, you know, before you take the testing, I always say, what are you going to do with the results? If it's elevated, as a veterinarian, we're going to recommend pergolide treatment to potentially improve the quality of your horse's life. Now, that's an expense that you may not be prepared for. But, you know, then you would have to make the decision, do I try the medication for 30 to 90 days and see how my horse responds? And then after that period of time, you have to decide, well, am I going to continue this as a lifelong medication? So it's either do you bury your head in the sand and just be happy with how your horse is right now, or do you want to know further? Okay. We would think that perhaps if your horse has laminitis concurrently, I'd be more likely to recommend testing and treatment. But if there's no laminitis or evidence of, you know, abnormal hoof growth when your farrier trims the horse, then it's, you know, it's really a personal decision. So other than diet and exercise, are there other preventive measures for according Cushing's? Now, diet and exercise are not going to prevent the progression of the melanotrope expansion and the loss of the dopaminergic neurons, okay? So it's not going to prevent development of Cushing's. Some people like to use antioxidants like vitamin E and vitamin C. And perhaps if we would have started a foal on vitamin E at a high level at day one of life for 20 or 30 years, maybe that could slow the progression of the oxidative damage that leads to Cushing's disease. But once they're 25 years old and they have signs of PPID, those antioxidants don't seem to be of much benefit.
Have you noted any risk for a horse showing an increased risk for laminitis if the horse does have insulin dysregulation and early signs of PPID?
So that's a big, good question. There's a lot of horses in the 15 to 20 years of age that are still in the show ring and doing quite well. The two big problems that we're seeing, if they are, again, a little bit overweight and have evidence of insulin dysregulation, is they can have very subtle laminitis. And that can be, you know, manifest as, you know, refusing jumps or just not extending out as well. And could be worthy of, you know, taking some foot radiographs and looking a little more critical for laminitis. The other thing that we see, especially in dressage horses, is upper suspensory ligament inflammation or injury, especially in the hind limbs. So suspensory ligament and even some tendon injuries, they could be a greater risk for if they have insulin dysregulation and still showing.
Chris, do we have any on Facebook Live?
No, we do not. Been kind of quiet there.
So again, there's a lot of confusion between EMS and PPID, or insulin dysregulation and PPID. I like to keep things sort of simple and straightforward. So I tend to think of them as different hormonal disease processes, PPID leading to the overproduction of the POMC and ACTH by the pituitary gland. The insulin dysregulation is an exaggerated insulin response to dietary sugar. Okay. Sure, they can occur together, but the testing then for those two diseases is different. For the insulin dysregulation or EMS, we're going to look at insulin responses, either just a basal insulin after eating or after the oral sugar test to exacerbate the insulin response. And with PPID, our screening test is going to look at ACTH. And fortunately, that ACTH is pretty steady over the course of the day. So we don't have to worry about fasting or any stimulation for the PPID testing as a screening test. You may have heard of giving a horse thyrotropin stimulating hormone or releasing hormone, TRH, for Cushing's disease. And that's because that's a stimulation test that will get a more dramatic increase in PPID, ACTH concentrations in PPID horses 10 minutes after giving that TRH. And so in horses that are in the earliest stages of diseases, sometimes the TRH test can be useful. But if we have a horse with clinical signs, it's in the 20s, just starting out with an ACTH is the best way to approach that. So Valerie asks, can ID horses have a false positive test result in the fall? And that's a good question. And actually, if I go back to my slides, I'll just give you one more slide here. This is some work that was done over in the United Kingdom looking at ACTH. And the normal value of ACTH should be less than about 35. Okay. And in a number of horses, they found that there is this seasonal increase in the fall. Okay. And that's probably an increase in the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis activity to help actually put some weight down and get horses prepared for the winter season. This is actually inverse in the southern hemisphere. The increase is in their winter in March through April. So we used to think that we shouldn't test in the fall to get these so-called false positives. But we now know that horses with PPID will have a more dramatic increase in ACTH in the fall rather than normal horses, which may only go up to about 50 or so. So we can actually use this window, especially the last couple weeks of September and the first couple weeks of October, as a tool to look for perhaps earlier stages of PPID. Because again, the PPID horse is more likely to have this fall rise be more dramatic than the normal horse, which might cut off at about 50 here. Okay, one or two more questions? Or
One more question, and then we're going to do our prize drawing. Okay. This is from Facebook Live. Have you found any correlation with vitamin E and selenium with insulin resistant horses?
That's a good question. We have not looked at that critically here at MSU. It's something that the Minnesota group's looked at a little bit, and I don't have a great answer for you on that, but clearly we're recognizing, horses that are on poor quality forage having lower vitamin E's that can lead to some muscle wasting. So if we are going on a poor quality diet to try to induce weight loss, we may want to monitor vitamin E a couple times a year. Now, the best source of vitamin E for horses is just fresh green grass pasture. So if they're on pasture at all, probably not concerned at all.